Again, a new season arrives, inviting us to move with the morning's winds, to let go with the falling leaves, to open and welcome autumn sun that shines softly like butter. The old season goes, lost to the folds of memory, its joy and its failures tucked in. And this, a new day, a new time. We breathe it in. Yes, we are alive, it says. Yes, we begin again. This is the gift. Let us breathe in cool dawns and darkening evenings. Let us be watchful of life's gifts of beginning anew and again, this day beckoning, that we become more fully who we were born to be, to do the work we are called to do. Come, let us worship and begin again. I invite you to join with me in singing our opening hymn, number 131, Love Will Guide Us.
Good morning. Welcome to First Parish in Milton. My name is Dottie Pitt, and I am a member of our worship committee. I'm trying something new this morning. I'm working from an iPad, but I have a backup plan in a notebook. So, if you are having trouble hearing us, please raise your hand in the meeting if you're here in the meeting house, or put something in the chat if you're on Zoom. We're so glad that you've chosen to be here this morning with us or to join us virtually. However your journey, whatever your heritage, and whomever you love, you are welcome here. Your presence on Sunday morning enriches worship for everyone. The sanctuary is made holy by your presence. If you are joining us for the first time, a special welcome. You will find information about First Parish in your pew. One of the greeters, or I, they're back there still letting people in, will be happy to escort you to coffee hour. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask us. The work of living our faith is done both in and out of worship, so I call your attention to the printed announcements that came in your order of service. Please take a look. And now I'd like to invite Lisa White up to talk about a very cool Halloween activity.
Thank you, Dottie. Good morning. This year, we're trying something new at Halloween. We're doing what's called a trunk or treat, which Dottie maybe more intuitively described as tailgate, trick-or-treat tailgating party. So we're doing it the Saturday before Halloween, October 29th in the afternoon. And the idea is that we will bring the trunks, decorated car trunks, and invite the community to come and trick-or-treat from trunk to trunk. So we're looking for helpers. If you can bring your car with your decorated trunk and distribute candy, we really need people to do that. But if you can donate candy or just help with sort of parking, directing, that kind of thing, it's quick. It's like an hour. So it should be fun, and I hope you will help. There are flyers in the back on the desk out there if you want some more information or talk to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. Now let's take a moment to greet each other and extend a warm welcome to old friends and new folks, staying in our seats to be COVID safe. And for those on Zoom, please go to gallery view and put your picture up and wave to each other, enjoy each other.
Morning.
Morning.
Good morning, everybody.
Good to see you.
Indeed it is.
Hello.
I'm not seeing anybody's pictures, but I've got a list, so it's good to see you all.
Okay.
Good to see all your names.
Oh, look, there's Pat.
Yes, indeed.
Now is the moment when we can focus on being here.
Bye.
When we can choose to connect with ourselves and the divine. When we can choose to just be present. I would like to invite Jeff Stoat up to light the chalice. He is the chairman of our Committee on Ministry. Flame of our faith, call us into the community of love and justice this morning and every morning. Thanks, Jeff. Now please join me in saying the call to worship. Come, let us gather. We gather to celebrate the sacred within and among us. We come to seek spiritual growth and understanding. We strive to practice acceptance, forgiveness, and love. We work to build a world with justice and compassion. Come, let us gather together. Now, I have a story to share with you, and it's about a boy named Ira, who was invited to sleep over at his friend Reggie's house. If you want to, close your eyes and think about a time when you slept at someone else's house. Maybe it was last week, maybe it was 50 years ago. Listen and see if you had an experience similar to Ira's and what kind of courage it took for Ira to spend the night at Reggie's house. I was invited to sleep at Reggie's house. Was I happy? I had never slept at a friend's house before, but I had a problem. It began when my sister said, "Are you taking your teddy bear?" "Taking my teddy bear?" I said, "Are you kidding me? Of course I'm not taking my teddy bear." And then she said, "But you've never slept without your teddy bear. Did you think about that? I'll be fine. I'll probably love sleeping without my teddy bear." But then she had me worried. What if I didn't like sleeping without my teddy bear? Should I take him? "Take him," said Mom. "Take him," said Dad. "But Reggie will laugh and say I'm a baby," I said. "He won't laugh," said Mom. "He won't laugh," said Dad. "He'll laugh," said my sister. I decided not to take my teddy bear. That afternoon, I played with Reggie. Reggie had big plans for the evening, which he eagerly shared me, ending with, "Ghost stories. We can tell ghost stories," he said. I was excited. By the way, I asked Reggie, what do you think about teddy bears? But Reggie just went on talking and planning about the ghost stories and stuff. About those ghost stories, does your house get very dark? I asked Reggie. Yeah, really dark, he replied. By the way, I said again, what do you think about teddy bears? Suddenly, Reggie was in a big hurry to go someplace. See you tonight, he said. I headed for home. I decided to take my teddy bear. Good, said my mom. Good, said my dad. But my sister said, what if Reggie wants to know your teddy bear's name? Tata is a silly baby name for a teddy bear. He won't ask, I said. He'll ask, she said. I decided not to take my teddy bear. And then it was time to go next door to Reggie's house. Good night, said my mom. Good night, said my dad. Sleep tight, said my sister. I went next door to Reggie's house. We played and played. We had a wrestling match and a pillow fight. Then Reggie's dad said, bedtime. Already, we said. Good night, said Reggie's dad. We got into bed. It was very dark. We can tell ghost stories, said Reggie, and he began. Once there was this ghost. He lived in this old haunted house. The house was empty. Nobody lived there except for the ghost because it was so scary. Everyone was so afraid of this ghost because he was scary to look at and made scary noises. Reggie stopped. Are you scared? He asked. Uh-huh, I said. Are you? Just a minute, Reggie said. I have to get something. Reggie went to his drawer and pulled something out. It was fuzzy. It had ears. I saw that it was a teddy bear. Now, about that ghost, Reggie said. Is that a teddy bear? I asked. What? Said Reggie. What are you holding? Is that a teddy bear? Do you sleep with him? Does he have a name? Yes, yeah, I sleep with him. His name is Fufu. Promise you won't tell anyone? I promise. Just a minute, I have to go get something, I said. The next minute, I was ringing my own doorbell. Ira, what are you doing here? Everyone said. I changed my mind, I answered. I decided to take Tata after all. I went upstairs and got Tata. My sister said, Reggie will fall down laughing. He won't, said my mom. He won't, said my dad. He won't laugh, I said. I came back to Reggie's room. I have a teddy bear too, I said. Do you want to know his name? There was no answer. I poked Reggie. He was fast asleep. Good night, I whispered to Tata. And I fell asleep too. Now let's sing our children, our religious explorers, off to their classes. Feel free to close your eyes if you'd like to and enjoy this piece of this time. The chime will signal the end of our silence. Our readings this morning are excerpts from Frederick Douglass's July 4th speech and White Fragility by Robin DiAngelo. From Frederick Douglass, narrative of the life of Frederick Douglass. I therefore hate the corrupt, slaveholding, women-whipping, cradle-plundering, partial and hypocritical Christianity of the land. I look upon it as the climax of all misnomers, the boldest of all frauds, and the grossest of all libels. Never was there a clearer case of stealing the livery of the court of heaven to serve the devil in. I am filled with unutterable loathing when I contemplate the religious pomp and show, together with the horrible inconsistencies which everywhere surround me. And now from Robin DiAngelo. Prior to the civil rights movement, it was socially acceptable for white people to openly proclaim their belief in racial superiority. But when white Northerners saw violence against black people, including women and children, and saw what they endured during the civil rights protests, they were appalled. These images became archetypes of racists. After the civil rights movement, to be a good moral person and to be complicit with racism became mutually exclusive. You could not be a good person and participate in racism. Only bad people were racist. To accomplish this adaptation, racism first needed to be reduced to simple, isolated, and extreme acts of prejudice. These acts must be intentional, malicious, and based on conscious dislike of someone because of race. Racists were those white people in the South smiling and picnicking at the base of lynching trees, store owners posting whites-only signs over drinking fountains, and good old boys beating innocent children such as Emmett Till to death. In other words, racists were mean, ignorant, old, uneducated Southern whites. Nice people, well-intended, open-minded middle-class people, people raised in the, quote, enlightened North, could not be racist.
Open up both of your
That was so beautiful. Thank you so much. Thank you. Good morning. It is good to be back in Milton, where two of my most beloved colleagues serve, the Reverend Lisa Ward, your minister who is on sabbatical, and the Reverend Tricia Brennan, who, as I understand it, is your sabbatical minister. So I'm honored to be in the pulpit that they share with me. So thank you for inviting me. And I want to thank Dottie Pitt in particular for helping to shepherd this morning's service. Milton, as you may or may not know, is a member congregation of the Unitarian Universalist Urban Ministry, where I serve. And you've supported us over time in many ways. Some of our supporters in Milton include Elise Henricks and Tony Dutzik, B.B. Williamson, Scott McIsaac and Suzanne Durrell, Carolyn Newman and Rick Malmstrom, Melinda and Harris Collins, Patricia and Mark Ostrom, Mary Blanchett, and James May. Thank you all. I also want to thank Mary Blanchett, Tracy Robinson, and Reverend Lisa for serving as your delegates to the Urban Ministry. In this role, they share with you news about the Urban Ministry and help you to engage in our work in Roxbury. It is good to be here on the cusp of autumn, when everything is changing. I love this season when it's still green but softening into yellow. A few leaves beginning to fall, the tomatoes done, the zinnias still bright. As a gardener, this marks an end to the gardening season, or at least the end of the growing season and the beginning of a season of dreaming and planning for next year. So I'm curious, are there any gardeners of any type here? Vegetable, flower, indoor, a lot of gardeners, awesome. So I've been a gardener since I was 11, when I went into my backyard and turned over some dirt and planted some carrots too closely, never thinned, and that emerged as these gargantuan bulbs with all these little spindly carrot legs. And I've continued over the years to dig in the soil, plant seeds, grow vegetables, always a somewhat impatient and impulsive gardener. Do we have any impatient, impulsive gardeners? Yeah, I'm so with you. So last year, I decided to slow down and really learn the practice of gardening. And I joined a master gardening certification program. Honestly, I'd be lying if I said I wasn't secretly drawn to the idea of becoming a master gardener, an expert holding vast expertise beyond that of ordinary gardeners. I imagined gathering this special knowledge that would make me feel super skilled at growing carrots and tomatoes. And then it was like this, having this door opened in this course, not to mastery, but to the vastness of all that I don't know. And what I earned my certification in was the certification of knowing all I don't know that I formerly didn't know that I didn't know. That's what my certification is in. So instead of tips on fertilizing tomatoes was this world of what it means to tend to the earth right around me and how much it matters and what a difference it makes. From the value of native plants to how rain from our gutter spouts flows onto driveways and then into the stormwater and pollutes the bay. About composting and soil health and invasive species and pollinator-friendly plants. Not only was this deep, wide universe of knowledge, I also learned everything wrong that I'd been doing. I'd been planting sun-loving things in the shade and over-mulching my trees, never mind things like carrots. The one thing that I most clearly learned upon completing my master gardening course is that if master gardening means being an expert, then I will never be one. I will always be learning and failing and learning and trying. And that is just what it feels like in my work at the Urban Ministry. This is what it feels like to do the work of racial justice, to begin a journey that is far more than I ever imagined, that I will never complete, never be an expert in, and that is more essential than I had ever known. So Milton is one of 46 Unitarian Universalist congregations around Greater Boston that are part of the Urban Ministry. And we are a 190-year-old nonprofit that has sought to make change in Boston since its founding. We were founded by the Reverend Joseph Tuckerman. He was a Unitarian clergyman committed to serving those who were financially poor and disenfranchised. According to the Dictionary of Unitarian and Universalist Biographies, quote, he simply went onto the streets of Boston. He introduced himself to people he identified as poor by their dress and conversation, invited himself into their homes, and talked with husbands, wives, and children. He sometimes offered assistance, a cord of wood, some money or clothes, and returned over and again, establishing affection and trust. He observed the immigrants grinding poverty and the ravages of alcohol in family life. He met young children sent out to steal and prostitute themselves, as well as the starving, widowed, and elderly invalids, end quote. He was committed to both listening to those who were oppressed and to educating privileged Bostonians about the lives of those in poverty and the injustice that created the poverty. He became known as the founder of modern social work. He merged the justice work of several Unitarian congregations, and since its beginning, the Urban Ministry's member congregations have been central to our work. Over time, we've done many things, built elder housing, founded a food pantry, staffed a legal clinic. Nearly 50 years ago, a single event steered our course toward where we are today. In 1976, one of the Urban Ministry member congregations, First Church in Roxbury, folded. The church had been founded in Roxbury in the 1600s by the Puritans, and the congregation worshiped there through the centuries. Its history became inextricably linked with the history of Roxbury itself. And it was the site of key moments in American history. Its steeple was a warning light during the siege of Boston. Patriot troops practiced on the green space, and the congregation hosted the funeral of abolitionist William Lloyd Garrison. Roxbury eventually became an affluent Boston suburb. But by the 1970s, the urban and suburban landscapes were changing, and Roxbury had become the heart of the African American community in Boston. Throughout the decades in Boston, government-sanctioned covenant restrictions, redlining, FHA policies had nurtured an exodus of white people from the city out to the suburbs, while African Americans found housing in neighborhoods like Roxbury, where banks refused home improvement loans and the government disinvested. It is in that context that the congregation of First Church Roxbury dwindled with the movement of white people away from the city and Roxbury to the suburbs. So First Church Roxbury's last living members decided to close, and they bequeathed to us their property and historic buildings, Boston's oldest surviving wood frame church building and a nearby parish hall, all on a large green space overlooking the Boston skyline. Back then, the Urban Ministry headquarters were in downtown Boston. But then instead of selling the Roxbury campus, which they may have considered, the urban ministry began operating youth programs in those old historic buildings. And then in 2002 came another pivotal moment. We sold our downtown campus headquarters and built a modern wing of classrooms in Roxbury and moved entirely there. And we dug more deeply into our work in the African American community. This is the place that you may have visited if you've come. Two stately and historic buildings in the center of Roxbury, connected by a sunlight-filled justice and education center. And that's the place that I came to 8 years ago when I joined. There were a number of programs underway, a domestic violence shelter, youth programming, weekend activities for young children. And beneath that array of programs pulsed something else. It was the work of confronting racism in Greater Boston. Our location cried out for it. That wasn't what I signed up for, though. So some of you may have heard this story before of my first week at the Urban Ministry. My first week, when I came to run these programs, the killers of Michael Brown were not indicted. Michael Brown, as you may recall, was an 18-year-old African-American youth shot and killed by police in Ferguson, Missouri in 2014. That week, my first, the staff came to me and asked me to make a public statement on the death of Michael Brown and the fact that the officers who killed him were not held accountable. I remember sitting in my office, nervous, lighting a candle and breathing, because I honestly didn't know what to do. I didn't want to make a statement because I was new, and I didn't know what to think about the killing of Michael Brown, and I didn't know how to talk about racism, and that wasn't the work that I came to do. I came to run programs to help people. That's what I came to do. But what I was called to do was a whole other matter. The Urban Ministry was given this extraordinary gift of location, one that we are called to live into. We are grounded in this amazing community of Roxbury. Its story tells the national story of racism, urban renewal, and segregation. It also, too, tells the story of resilience, Black community organizing, and resistance, and cultural richness. And we are encircled by suburban congregations and suburban communities, also shaped by racism in reverse, shaped by policies that have given benefits to people who are white, policies that have kept these communities white by design, and that have UU congregations in the center of them, congregations who increasingly also feel called to dismantle racism and have the power to make change. This is an extraordinary opportunity for our faith to dismantle racism and white supremacy culture and to work for real justice. Over time, this work at the intersection of communities has cured me of my reluctance to deal with race. I continue to learn about the history of race and how racism is foundational in this country, how it shows up in every single system, that it is the root cause of enormous injustice and suffering, from the racial wealth gap to the shorter lifespan of Roxbury residents, to the heart of the prison industrial complex, to the foundation of our segregated communities. A little over a year ago, the Urban Ministry adopted a new mission statement that faced that reality head on. We committed to dismantle racism and white supremacy culture and to advance racial, social, and economic justice. Since then, we have been deep in conversation about how to now shift our work and focus more squarely on that mission. It is hard and messy work. It takes trying and learning and rolling up our sleeves. And as I go through this work, I bring with me the lessons from the garden, and they are these. Number one, our first lesson, my first lesson, test your soil. That is, what is in this soil? What is our history? What is beneath our feet? The urban ministry has committed itself to examining our history, the inherited history of First Church Roxbury, and the history of the urban ministry. In the spring, we engaged a researcher to look into the history of enslavers and those who had been enslaved who were connected with First Church in Roxbury. He is right now completing his research, which shows the troubling depth of enslavement that is related to this church that we inherited, with even its very first minister an enslaver. When I began talking this morning, I shared the history of how we inherited our historic campus by white flight in 1976, because it's important that we name inheriting this space that's in the heart of Roxbury. That is part of our legacy. We also need to look more closely at the urban ministry itself as an historically white-led organization to look at our stories and our mistakes. We all need to do this work. In Robin DiAngelo's book, White Fragility, we hear from African-American scholar Amawale Akintundo, who said, quote, racism is a systematic, societal, institutional, omnipresent, and epistemologically embedded phenomenon that pervades every vestige of our reality, end quote. But for white people, DiAngelo says, it's invisible to us, like water. We see race as something that is part of a black community, like Roxbury, but not necessarily as part of our white communities and history. And our work is to learn to see the water in which we are swimming. Quote, predominantly white neighborhoods, said DiAngelo, are not outside of race. They are teeming with race, end quote. One way to see that water is telling and holding up the histories that underpin our churches, our communities, our institutions. Number two, fix the soil. At the urban ministry, we commit to change, change from within. 2 years ago, after the murder of George Floyd, our organization made some clear commitments. One was researching our history, which is underway. Another is ensuring greater representation of people of color on our board. The priority for our nominating committee has been cultivating and engaging more community members so our board looks like the communities that we seek to partner. UUs, many of whom are white, former program participants, mostly people of color, and Roxbury community members of color. Today, 6 of 15 board members are people of color, and when I come back to you next year, I hope I'll be able to tell you it is near half. We've also diversified our staff leadership and are working to recruit volunteers of color so that at every level there is shared power. Without shared power, injustice persists. Fix the soil. Lesson three from the garden. Plant plants where they want to be planted. For years, I planted plants where I thought they would look good. I didn't pay attention to the direction or the shade or the wind, and that's why my lilac bush didn't bloom when I planted under a large oak tree. Likewise, we cannot create programs based on what staff or congregation or the board think sounds good. We need to hear from the community that we are part of about what the community wants. This summer, we convened focus groups of Roxbury business owners to ask how we can partner in closing the racial wealth gap. That information will shape a pilot program, probably to launch this winter, that will seek to match skills and abilities from member congregations and match them with the businesses seeking to grow in ways that they're asking for. And we've been meeting with Roxbury nonprofits to see how they want to partner with our member congregations. This summer, City Life Vita Urbana, which protects the rights of tenants in Black neighborhoods facing eviction through gentrification, they came and asked us to help with a mailing. And UUs from member congregations came in and helped to mail 1,500 tenants facing eviction notification of their rights. We need to listen and listen and keep listening. There are wonderful opportunities to plant the right thing when we do. Lesson 4, pull weeds early. Over time, we have faced the legacy of well-intentioned, but sometimes clumsy people who are white, like me, who, seeking to do work in a Black community, sometimes make assumptions and say the wrong things. Sometimes it's staff, sometimes board, sometimes volunteers. The stories are painful and they echo through our organization. We're committed to doing better. So we have been building a more robust onboarding program that sets a higher bar for engaging with our neighbors, one that offers cultural competence training, an understanding of Roxbury history, and an understanding of how our communities became so segregated. We all need to learn, too, how to give and receive hard feedback when we say and do things that perpetuate racism and that hurt. Every gardener knows it's best to pull weeds as soon as you see them. And finally, the fifth lesson. Truly lasting gardens are not built in a day. When we adopted our new mission statement last year, it was the end of a multi-year journey. But this new mission is now the beginning of another long journey. I have felt the impatience at living into it, and I have also realized the reality is that it will take more than my own lifetime to complete it. There will be setbacks, but what matters is that we stay the course, learning, stumbling, trying, and committed. This summer, after I'd had my Master Gardener's course, I again grew tomatoes. I don't know if it was the summer's heat or my soil, but most of my crops suffered from this awful, unsightly blossom rot. They were ruined. I was so discouraged. But that failure was also an opportunity to learn more. As I complained about it to my fellow gardeners, I learned that it might be a calcium deficiency, and I learned how to add calcium to improve it. I learned it might be the pH and how to deal with that. In gardening, you have to take a long view. A beautiful garden isn't built in a season. It will take years. Years to learn and do and undo, years of letting things blossom and fill in, years of reading and working with other gardeners and doing too. It takes many mistakes and seasons of trying again. The only real mistake is giving up. So I am here this morning to invite you to deepen your work in Milton with ours, to learn with us, and to support us. In the year ahead, we will roll out new walking tours to share the stories of Roxbury. Come in for a tour and to learn. We'll pilot a new program to partner with Roxbury businesses to address the racial wealth gap. Sign up to share your expertise or make a donation to fund it. We'll again air our webinar series, Community Conversations, highlighting Roxbury leaders on issues that they want addressed. Sponsor conversation as a congregation and watch it. And we'll roll out our new volunteer training. Sign up for it. This season in my garden, I didn't do all I wanted. My potato crop was sparse, and you heard about my tomatoes. But I planted bushes of goldenrod for the pollinators that took, and deep purple stevia for migrating hummingbirds. And I imagine what's possible as I persevere, and what's possible if we all do that, all keep trying and tending. What it will look like as the earth greens and what we've planted blossoms, bright and hopeful, and more like the world that our faith calls us to. Amen. I invite you to join me in hymn number 18 in the gray hymnal, What Wondrous Love. I invite us to take a deep breath, settle back into our seats, and come fully into this place and this moment. We gather in gratitude for a new day with all the opportunities that lie in front of us. We give gratitude for all the gifts and blessings that enabled us to arrive here this morning. the ability to move, to breathe. And we lift up our concerns in the wider world. We lift up our thoughts for all those in Florida who are suffering the loss of everything. And we wish all those dealing with that crisis strength, the support of community, and a wider community still. We lift up our prayers for those in Ukraine who are dealing with violence and loss. And even as we lift up our prayers for all those places in the world that struggle with violence and hunger, we also lift up to our personal struggles, which are real and true. We lift up those people in our lives who are sick. We lift up worries in our relationships. And as we breathe in and breathe out, we lift up hopes to remember presence and courage and gratitude as we move through every challenge before us. Together, we enter into a moment of silent prayer. Amen.
Good morning. I don't have an iPad. I just have a piece of paper. Many of you know about Reclaim Our Vote, but I'm going to give a little snapshot now. Reclaim Our Vote is a nonpartisan campaign, which is part of the Center for Common Ground. Their mission is to empower underrepresented and disenfranchised voters, many of whom are of color. They do this by providing voter education on how to monitor your voter registration status and to find voting locations such as voting centers, drop boxes, and voting precincts. Before the 2020 election, we organized our congregation to help get this information to key states of Alabama, Arizona, Florida, Texas, Georgia, Mississippi, and North and South Carolina. About 40 of us back then hand wrote over 1,000 postcards, and many others also became involved with phone banking and texting. In total, I'm impressed with this. In total, Reclaim Our Vote sent out 9 million postcards, 1.7 million phone calls, and 2.9 million texts. Currently, they have a campaign to help people in Arizona and other states to vote in this midterm election. This church's Social and Environmental Justice Committee will be discussing our possible ability to move forward with this year's postcarding campaign. Please help Reclaim Our Vote continue to do this important work. Thank you.
Thank you, Cynthia. I know many of us have written letters, as witnessed by what Cynthia said, and made calls to get out the vote. It's so important. Today's offering will be given to reclaim our vote. We will support the UU Urban Ministry after the election. We thought it was important now to support the Reclaim Our Vote efforts. To give, please follow the instructions in your order of worship or shown on the Zoom screen. For those in the meeting house, you may also leave a donation if you'd like to leave an in-person donation in the plates at either of the doors at the entrance. If you are proud of this church, become its advocate. If you care about its future, share its message. We welcome all to build a just and healthy world with faith, love, and compassion. Please support our faith community by giving as generously as you can.
Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve the world. Rejoicing. Love and serve the world. Rejoicing. And go forth into the world in peace, and be of good courage, love and serve the world rejoicing.
And dedication. May these gifts be transformed into strength for this faith community, into comfort, food, and shelter for those in need. And may we be transformed by generosity. We will close the service by singing hymn number 121 in the gray hymnal, We'll Build a Land. But before we do that, I just want to acknowledge we are not a very big church, and we have two incredible tenors. Thank you.
In the end, the only true mistake in gardening would be to stop. Go forth, nurturing the earth under your feet and the community that is all around us that needs the gifts that you bring to the work of justice. Go out in peace and courage and faith. Amen.